teach our children to drive, we don't tell them that this is going to be a fun experience, that they can go as fast as they want, that they can go on the wrong side of the road, that they have freedom to do anything, which of course they do. Of course they have freedom to do anything. But we let them know that there is a code of ethics, that there is the right side of the road to go on, that there is an obedience to certain symbology, red lights, green lights. You have to understand that if you go very fast that you can have a crash. I think this is the concern of the Harry Potter series, is that it's enticing children to dabble more into the occult, to search out the occult. The point is the power of Harry Potter something that is addictive? It draws them into darker powers and into something that ultimately will destroy society.
Harry, with the talent of Laurence of Olivier, feigned surprise. I can't be a wizard. I'm just Harry, again with the oil of Olivier. Yeah, something about doing that voice, like maybe the tremolo or something, just makes me like squirm, real squirmy when I'm doing it.
My experience of being a fan has changed because of what I do. My name is Melissa Anelli. My website is The Leaky Cauldron. We are a Harry Potter website, a general destination for fans. It's a job, for lack of a better word. It's giving the fans the stuff to obsess about, the stuff to do, the way in which they can most enjoy being a fan during this specific time in Harry Potter history. But I'm a reporter for the daily newspaper out here, and that is my day job. I work 8 hours, sometimes more, and then I come home and do this for fun. I can't imagine right now experiencing this time, experiencing this phenomenon differently. How many people are going to be able to say that when they, you know, that I experienced this to the utmost, this great time in literary history, and I was right there at the front of it.
Now imagine a music, dear readers, heavy with cellos at a rapid staccato. Cellos held between thighs in a dark room, the little room of Harry's chest.
This is my shed in the backyard. 4 years ago, we played our first show, and then we sat down, just wrote a bunch of like quick little songs. We performed them pretty poorly inside here.
Ladies and gentlemen, Harry and the Potter!
We didn't really know anything about like fan culture when we started the band. We just sort of did it. A lot of my friends were just like, what are you doing, you know? Like, why are you wasting your time? And then as it sort of started to take off, they still couldn't understand it, really. And we're like, we're going on tour. And they're like, why? Who wants to see you play? It's funny, because now they've kind of come around, you know? Like, they want to be a part of it. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, dude.
No problem.
We squashed the book.
All you witches and wizards out there, where are you ready to burn Voldemort's butt? Wait, I didn't hear that. A little louder. Yeah. Woohoo! But we still need to work on it.
Hi, my name is Holden, and I'm 4,
and you're in the adventurers band.
Yeah, and I am in the ventures band.
Hi, I'm Darius, I'm 7 years old, and I'm in the Hungarian Horntails band.
I'd come up with a song in the morning, and then hum it through the day, and at night when they fell asleep, I'd record it, and the next morning, they're like, you know, what's your new song? What's your new song? And then Darius got very excited to finally do his wizard dragon rock stuff.
There, I'm ready.
1, 2, 3, action! Dragon rock rolls! Dragon rock rolls! Dragon rock rolls!
All the time!
Dragon rock rolls!
sort of battling to who's going to be using GarageBand today or what's going on, Holden.
All the time! Drag and rock! All the time! Drag and rock.
There would always be music in the house. There's guitars in every room. There is musical instruments, cameras. I believe if you want to do something, you just do it. I think it's really great that they have no fear to do whatever they feel like doing.
Hey, put those back in there.
I remember having to tell my boss that, hey, you know, I gotta take off work because we're going to a Wizard Rock show and like, well, there's these books, Harry Potter. You know, you ever heard it? You know, there's the movie. Well, there's a band that dress like Harry Potter and sing about Harry Potter. We have to go to it because my son, who sings about dragons, is also playing.
It's awesome when you get seven-year-olds headbanging and starting their own bands. Wizard rock.
It's a genre now, legitimately, apparently.
I thought we made up the word.
Yeah, no, we did. I'm pretty sure we made that up. I sort of had that idea. The idea struck me, Harry and the Potters.
While the idea was sitting around, I was playing in my other band, Ed and the Refrigerators, and we were playing a show at Mass Art. I was about like 13 at the time, and this girl screamed, "I love you, Harry Potter," because I guess I resembled Harry Potter a little bit. And after the show, Paul's like, if you ever want to take that Harry and the Potters idea, you totally can. We decided not to fight over who got to be Harry Potter, and we figured we both can be Harry Potter, just have Harry Potter from different points in time. So it's really more like a solo project than a band.
Reading is the key to fighting evil.
And knowledge.
What are you, fighting knowledge?
No, the key to knowledge.
Okay.
Paul's always been really helpful in getting me interested in music and stuff. Like, he got me like my first CDs, and now pretty much we listen to all the same stuff because we're together so much. This is our wardrobe here.
I definitely get the sense that we're almost like the same person, you know? We're not just brothers, we're sort of like best friends at this point.
Well, we went to the coffee tea shop on our first date. And it started off great. Well, maybe I shouldn't have mentioned Hermione. And maybe you shouldn't have brought up Cedric Diggory. Because I'd rather not talk about your dead ex-boyfriends over coffee. Why'd you have to bring up Roger Davies when he's sitting right there with his tea? 'Cause if you wanted to go out with Roger Davies, baby, how come you're here with me? So Jack, what you like
it long ago, just buy a whole bunch of guitars that don't really mean a lot and leave them lying around. So even our one-year-old will drag the guitars around.
My mom and dad got this guitar for me, and you meant for me, you and me.
Yeah, for you.
Tina and I met a couple times at a few shows, probably in the early to mid-90s. But we really met when we were in the same band together.
I was sort of just staying at my mom's house for a little bit and decided to form a band called the Black Cocks with some friends, and one of them was Ian.
It was actually on Valentine's Day at our friend Mike's house, who's Order of Merlin.
We played a couple shows, and then like a couple months later we got married.
we flew to Vegas, stayed there for a week, got married with Elvis in like the little chapel of flowers or something. Punk rock love, I guess.
Let's hear it for the library! Yeah! All right, so cool. This is awesome. I'm Harry Potter year 4, and that's Harry Potter year 7.
When we were just starting out, we were playing like lots of libraries in and around Boston.
And that's all we really expected of it. Like, let's see if we can write enough songs for a set and then see if we can book a show at the Boston Public Library. And maybe it got written up in the newspaper.
We really only started playing shows a lot like right before my senior year in high school. Some of my teachers would be like, hey, you were in the paper this morning. Everybody, check this out. It's kind of like a red cheek moment. I mean, I was in classes with kids who read a lot, and they understood.
You ran for class president. Yeah. Didn't win.
You didn't win?
No, I lost by a few votes. I had a pretty good campaign, like, vote for Joe, he's a wizard. Vote for Joe, he owns a shovel. It was my dad's shovel. I lost to Pat Thornton. He can eat my dirt.
Hey, Pat Thornton, are you in a documentary?
We thought it was just a one-time joke. This is one joke for our friends, and we were never going to play these songs again.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for coming. Fairfield, Connecticut. We're Draco and the Malfoys. Mostly we sing songs about how we don't like Harry Potter.
This feels like it's going well. Do you think it's going well? Are you getting good stuff? Okay. My friend Matt from the Whomping Willows was having house parties where he would have bands play. I had discovered Harry and the Potters on the internet, and I was like, Matt, you have to have these guys play at your party. And he had discovered them right around the same time, so he called them, and then they had to cancel. So we figured everyone else was going to be disappointed too, and maybe we could play songs about Harry Potter to kind of make up for the fact that they weren't there. And then that's when we started talking about doing things from Draco's perspective.
My dad is rich, and your dad is dead. My dad is rich, and your dad is dead. Your dad's on his journey to the great beyond. When you're dueling, you might see him come out of someone else's wand.
A few months later, Harry and the Potters needed an opening act, and they called us up and asked us to play, and it went over big at their show.
My dad is rich and your dad is dead.
Once we started playing more often, we were like, Matt, get this together. We're having a blast here. At the time, he really didn't seriously believe that he was going to be able to make songs from the perspective of the Whomping Willows.
Ever since he's been writing songs, he would be like kind of splitting the difference between being like serious and things that, you know, mattered, boring things like love and stuff like that. And then he'd write like awesome funny songs about eggplants and like doing strange things to cats. And then when he got into college, he kind of stopped writing the silly stuff. I missed it. And then when he started the Whomping Willows, it was like, welcome back.
Yeah.
Hi, how's it going? I'm the Whomping Willow.
About a year ago, I played my first rock show. I was feeling kind of nervous about how it would go. So I talked to my rock star friend, Draco, and he said, hey man, don't fret. 'Cause Wizard Rock fans are the sweetest bunch of fans, and most of them are girls, and you're basically a man. So get out there, killer, and rock it like you can. And so that's what I did. It soon became clear that rocking wasn't enough. If you're gonna score with groupies, then you gotta be a hunk. Can't get by with overwhelming talent alone. And man, that's all I got. Man, that's all I got.
There are a few people that seem to show up at multiple shows. The last time we were in California, there were a couple of girls that showed up to every show we played in the state, and it was like, you know, like 9 shows or something.
I've been into Wizard Rock for about 2 years now. My father actually got me into it. He came home one day and told me about Harry and the Potters. And I just started looking online for Harry Potter sites and then found a bunch of different bands. And then I started going to concerts. And since then, I've just been really into it. It just kind of gave me a place to belong. It gave me a group of people that I'm part of. I probably have more friends through Harry Potter than I've made anywhere else.
Could have been a Wizard Rock heartthrob. Could have been the star of the show. Could have been a Wizard Rock heartthrob. But Dumbledore found Matt Majacomo.
Thank you so much. I'll talk to you guys soon.
We love you, Matt.
I love you too.
I make sandwiches at Jay's Deli.
Best sandwiches in Rhode Island.
I have a 2- or 3-year-old son, and sometimes I just have to make concessions. Like, I play drums for Harry and the Potters. They had asked me to go on tour in March, and I just told them, no, I can't do it. I have a 3-year-old and a job, and just like, yeah, it's a bummer I can't go. And my girlfriend was like, why not?
I was like, well, because I'm trying to be a good dad, like, be around, like, keep my job. He's like, you have to do this.
You're crazy, just go. Like, you can find another job at a deli if you have to. And we'll be fine. You're right. This is what I do.
This is a song called Remember Cedric Diggory. Okay, I'm gonna change that a little. All right, I just ran all the way down my van for my guitar, so I'm a little out of breath, and it's hard to sing. Okay. Ministry said it was an accident. Dumbledore knew that was a lie.
It's really awesome to see all these bands sort of crop up.
There's a MySpace group that hosts all the Wizard Rock bands.
There's a lot. 50, 100. Everybody's picking names, like the Peeves and the Poltergeists.
The Wands, they write all their songs about being a wand. That's really creative.
Don't wanna stay in this cemetery. Just wanna see my father again.
Definitely, I see the correlation between the people that everyone we know has chosen.
Bring my body back.
With Cedric, I don't know what that correlation is. I don't know. He's some sort of athlete that I didn't know.
I don't know. I guess I'm a Troy Wizard champion.
No, but Cedric was a good guy. I'd have to say that Ian is a good guy.
I guess a good guy that really awful things happen to. Maybe that's it. You know. Yeah. His death is so fast, you have this buildup of this like superhero guy. As soon as he gets into the cemetery, just kill this bear, and he's dead. And that's it. There's no, oh, I'm dying, Harry, save me.
One of my favorite things that you said when we first met was, I'm the kind of guy that's gonna be walking down the street, shot right in the head, drop dead, like that.
And so maybe really that's the feeling subliminally. Yeah. It's the same kind of a feeling. You know, like the wrong place at the wrong time, maybe.
Good guy walking down the street.
Good guy walking down the street.
Dead.
Thank you.
Oliver. Avada Kedavra. Anyway, okay.
Actually, this is pretty much just like the only hat that fits my enormous head.
Mike, he was the first among us, our group, to put his own song up. So. He was an influence to us, I guess, too. Hey, Darius.
Compared to most Wizard Rock bands that we've heard, we're kind of a train wreck, and I think it will be a bit of a shock to some of the kids tonight.
Grop. Man, Grop was good.
you know, like Cookie Monster stuff. Yeah. Really.
Really challenging.
Really hardcore.
Oh, Spencer. Come here, Spencer. Oh, have you had enough? Oh. It's okay. It's okay. Daddy's here. We are just about done.
Yeah.
It is hard. It is hard, for instance, to find people outside of Wizard Rock that are, A, going to take what we do seriously and, you know, support it or think it's funny or I'd even just be happy with a lack of hatred or derision, you know. But
Holden, what did you get your ideas from?
I got my ideas from birds and from groundhogs and from rockets and from robots.
What about scissors?
And from scissors.
You know, our father's been a scientist, and we've always had like kind of science magazines lying around the house, and it's just been a very interesting part of culture to be, you know, in tune with, because there's so much going on and people are very innovative with it and creative. I'm gonna study science. It's like the new magic.
Guys, you still want the sand? You still want the sand?
No.
There's always that option of buying the camper and going on tour as the Wizard Rock Partridge Family or Punk Rock Partridge Family, or, you know, that's a dream. It'd be really nice to do, not work the 9-to-5 and be able to make your art and get paid for it.
Said right into Ron's soul, you know what we are, baby. We are wizards. We are finally what we were always going to become. We are wizards, and the world better get ready, because I have just begun.
My name's Brad Neely. The best thing to say first is that it wasn't a movie I made. Before I knew it, people were calling it a movie, and why not go along with that? All right, I made a movie. But I didn't. I made an audio track. It's called Wizard People, comma, Dear Readers. You can play it in a CD player while you're watching the DVD of the first Harry Potter movie with the sound down. And if you get it right, you hear my words instead of what's playing on the movie. Do you want a chair? It's all right.
Yeah.
I don't know the book. See, I'm just a movie person. Initially, I thought that I would make a totally misinformed book on tape version of Harry Potter, where when the person recording it had not ever read the book and was just really into the movie. I had witnessed adult friends of mine to camping out to get the book, and I wanted to have an adult narrator that was that even crazily more excited than that and just looked. Saw these kids as these mega gods, these heroes. As soon as I had it synced and on a CD, I just rushed over to the same guy's house. Watch this. No, I don't want to watch Harry Potter. Can we just watch like the first half? But as it turns out, luckily, it's fun to watch the whole thing.
Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, a book on tape. The child sorting hat ceremony begins, and Harry thinks to himself that this will be a long, long night. Mouth oil is called to face the grinding hat, but before his ash cheeks can even start to pancake out on the stool, he is assigned to Slytherin. Professor Hardcastle tries to say Harry Potter like it is no big deal. This damn hat all these fucking kids and teachers looking at him like a fucking television. I don't care, fuck it, just don't put me with mouth oil, is all Harry keeps thinking. Finally, the hat's oscillations tense and release upon Harry's scalp. Gryffindor it is, yes! And the universe sighs its magical sigh. Yeah.
I do think it's to the point now where the fans feel like we're all in this big thing together and we're all experiencing this together. With every book release and with every movie release, the sites get bigger and bigger and bigger. My website is primarily a news site, but in the last year or so, we started a podcast. It's just us talking about Harry Potter. It's become this sort of freewheeling talk show, and it has gained a rabid fan following, and that has changed the entire nature of Harry Potter fandom. It was just a huge explosion.
Thank you.
People have started to see the people who run the fan sites as people they look up to.
Thank you.
And so now you have like a second tier of fan. There are fans of the books, and then there are fans of the fans. All of a sudden we had this group of users at our disposal who wanted to help. People just want to come and do things for the site. And so now there's sort of like this army of fan reporters of Harry Potter.
My name is Heather Lovert. I had become immersed in the Harry Potter world. That was when I was 13 years old, and a couple months later, I met several people who were running other Harry Potter sites. This friend and I, we created the Daily Prophet, which was an online newspaper for children that focused on creative writing. Hey, Dad. It worked really well. The kids really got into it. They were having a great time working with Harry Potter. They felt immersed in the world that they love so much, and they felt like they were a part of something. I never really thought that I would become involved in some huge legal battle. I thought that I was just a small little website doing its job, teaching a few kids how to write. But then one day, a friend of mine, she had gotten a letter from Warner Brothers telling her that if she did not shut down her website, they would sic their lawyers on her. And basically, she was scared out of her mind. She was this 12-year-old girl who thought that she was going to go to prison because she was running a Harry Potter fan site. And apparently this letter campaign that Warner Brothers had started had been going on under my nose for months. I don't know why I knew better, but I just knew that that letter was full of baloney, and I knew that I could do something about it.
And that's where this website comes in. It's called potterwarg.org. It's launched in part by a 16-year-old from Reston, Virginia, and it's the centerpiece of a campaign to boycott all things Harry Potter. Heather, good morning to you.
Good morning.
It was a worldwide boycott. We had people petitioning for us and picketing in London. We had people in Poland. There was a huge group of people in Poland who had been threatened. I became the spokeswoman for the campaign and orchestrated a worldwide boycott against all things Harry Potter except the books. We didn't have an argument with J.K. Rowling, so we were going to keep buying the books like usual, but we weren't going to go see the movies. We weren't going to buy any of the toys. Nothing. Just anything that was Harry Potter was off limits. It took quite a while before we got in contact with someone at Warner Brothers. For a while, they just kind of thought of us as the Potterwar problem. They refused to dignify our questions with any answers. But thankfully, once we had been on the cover of USA Today, we finally got their attention.
Come on in, Harry.
You're in a spot, boy. Serious charge against you.
What charge?
Vandalism. Willful and malicious destruction of property.
Then the story takes a weird turn.
Sit down, boy.
I got a call. We really like your wizard people stuff. Do you want to have us show this at this film festival? And it started to generate
more interest from different festivals. Well, hey, we heard about your thing. Can we play it at the... sure, I guess. Here's the CDs. I just send them CDs and they would rent the movie or whatever. Pretty soon I'm getting a lot of emails from people who are just really liking it. Man, you should do it on the East Coast. You should come up and do it live in New York and Boston and Baltimore and DC. So that's great, you know? But I was really initially scared that possibly it was illegal. As, you know, like, can you really do that? They assured me that it would be fine or we would deal with it if something came up. The way that the story goes, there's so much. I'm not a paranoid person, but if I was, this would have sent me over the edge, because this story is laced with all this. It makes you think that corporations have these sleeper agents. There are these guys in like trench coats and hats, and they work for Warner Brothers, and they're just looking for people who are fucking with their property, you know? And there's one of these sleeper agents who woke up one day and smoking his cigarette and taking his Warner Brothers diary out and making his log, and he's flipping through the weekly paper, and there's Brad Neely's interview talking about how they fucking tore open some Warner Brothers property, and this guy like, fuck that, and he gets the phone and he's like, give me headquarters.
Transmit the alarm to the police?
Huh? We'll pick him up.
So pretty soon, Warner Brothers found out that this theater was gonna do this unholy thing with their product. And they called him up and said, if you do this, then you can never show another Warner Brothers movie. I've been waiting for this move the whole time, and here it comes. And it's like, you can feel it coming in the waves. Oh my God, that was Warner Brothers. They just shut down Boston. They're coming, and they're coming to get us, I'm sure. I'm afraid only like three or four 14-year-olds are gonna show up to enjoy this anyway. Like, what, is it really worth it, you know? I can just have the beer and not do it.
If you threaten one of us, you're gonna threaten all of us. And that was the attitude we took with Potter War, that it didn't matter how young you were, how small your sight was, if you got threatened, all of us got threatened and we were all going to react accordingly. This boycott rapidly spread everywhere because it was so borderless and worldwide. Our numbers just grew rapidly to the point where at one point we had 15,000 people sign our petition. Finally, it really made Warner Brothers notice that we were serious, and hitting them in the wallet really worked.
I mean, think about it for a moment. Here's a young girl who, at the age of 14 and 15, begins to become part of a conversation publicly to challenge the studio's rights to assert their control over intellectual property. She goes on national television and debates the value of fan participation. And through this process, she gets Warner Brothers to rethink their position on intellectual property. They pull back, they reassess what they're doing, they begin to publicly acknowledge they've made mistakes, and they begin to change how they relate to the fan community.
I forget where we are. Oh, hold on. The film festival played the show and people really liked it. Turns out that there were a lot of people there. I'm shaking their hands and looking around waiting for those trench coat guys to show up and get me. And then this guy comes out who's part of the film festival. He's like, they have a name. They have a name. They know you.
Harry.
What? They know my name? And they're like, no, but they have it. They think your name is Healy. So it's like, okay, that's cool. They had got the call, of course, because that dude smoking the cigarette, making his logs, had called the New York branch, Sleeper Cells, Warner Brothers agents, and said, you've got to shut this fucking shit down right now. New York gets shut down. They're like, there's an after party. You want to just secretly do it at the party? I'm like, no fucking way. There are going to be agents all over that place. Or, you know, I was just afraid that I couldn't even say Harry Potter in a restaurant without getting in trouble after that.
I understand that on a legal basis, Warner Brothers does have to protect what they own. They own the rights to the words Hogwarts and Hagrid and Harry Potter. We wanted the same rights that any fan should have. People used to have clubhouses for Howdy Doody or any other TV show or book, but because it's on the internet, it was threatening, and we wanted to show that we weren't threatening, we were just fans of the books, and remind them that the fans are what gives them their money and gives them their power. And without the fans, they don't have that anymore.
If we want to describe a single moment that changes the way Hollywood thinks about its fans, it's the moment when Warner Brothers says, let's rethink this thing. Let's reimagine what the relation is between Harry Potter fans and the Harry Potter franchise.
If movies have taught us anything, when the man comes down on you, you gotta get everybody together and do the one thing that the man is mad about. And if you do a lot of it, and the man's like, it's actually pretty cool. The man ends up liking it, and then everything's fine. So everybody, every Harry Potter fan should record a commentary for Harry Potter 2, which would be really easy, because that movie is really good. All right. We can have, like, little puppets. And I don't remember if it's on the right or left side. I do think he's appropriately angry. Give him a little bit of a wand. The wand, the most phallic of all weapons. See, this is highly illegal right here. I mean, we might as well move to Mexico right the fuck now. Ronnie has kind of more of a butt haircut. We're just gonna, I forget really what Ronnie looks like, so he's always eating. Let's give him a Twizzler, because Ronnie loves Twizzlers. That should be red. And Hermione, the wretched creature, has complex on top of complex. Her hair, nest of horrible snakes, a prepubescent Medusa. She's got crazy eyes. And again, I really, these kids are adorable and great actors, and I feel bad that I'm tearing the crap out of her. Her hair needs to be even more snaky. And then she always has, like, the way that girls walk around at school hugging their books, especially her, because she needs something to hug. It's like Christmas vacation is starting, and Ron and Harry are playing chess. They're testing their strategical wits. Harry is the superior to Ron in most fields, but Ron is the champion of chess, and he could beat almost any god, including Harry. Harmony makes her way through the mostly empty cafeteria and sits down with our heroes, who are testing their strategical wits with a thunderous game of chess. Harmony feels small in their presence, so she decides to split hairs with the bear. Say, Ron, you look tired. Have you ever been tested for diseases? Ron replies, at least I'm not a hideous fucker. She says, are you going home for Christmas? I'm going home. My family's got money.
He's like, no, we're gonna stay here and find out who Nick Flannel is and rule the fucking school. So go on home and open your presents. I hope you get a new pillow to cry into.
I don't want to go home for Christmas this year. I don't want to see my family. I just want to stay at school for this winter break. I just want to stay at school with my best friend Ron. Oh, oh, whoa-oh. We'll spend our Christmas playing wizard chess. Oh, oh, whoa-oh. Playing wizard chess this Christmas. Christmas, oh yeah!
one culture town. Well, in all, it's a small town. It could be taken 50 years ago and plopped into today, and probably not much has changed, except for a little more traffic.
Cool, man, rock on.
It's a town of pickup trucks, you know?
Ah, awesome.
That is so cool. We have a TV, but it only picks up one station, PBS. If you're gonna have one station for kids, it's gonna be PBS.
I like guessing how much money things are gonna cost.
And the scale and the condition.
$2,000 or $3,000.
I'd rather have the kids doing what they're doing instead of watching cartoons all day, I guess. You know, being able to do whatever they want to do.
In this condition, at auction, it's worth over $10,000. We think it could bring as much as
12 or 14,000.
That's an offshoot of when Darius did start first grade. He was still in banker mode.
And that's...
That was his normal attire for
every day.
Think about what you did when you were 7. You know, nothing. I played t-ball. This kid's got a band.
Darius loves being the boss, I think. Whatever projects he sees us doing or other people, he ends up, I'm gonna do that. And I'm gonna do it this way.
Oliver, no. Gonna get off stage, but I'm still here, so this next song is called I'm a Dragon and I Don't Care. So let's do this. I am a dragon and I don't care. I just like seeing people scared. I am a dragon and I don't care. I just like seeing people scared. Cause I am a dragon and I don't care. I just like burn phone Mars, but dead deers, they run down the street going high like wallabies, sucking their thumbs and saying, Mama, where? Cause I got killed. I am a dragon and I don't care. I just like saying, people scared!
Dumbledore took me out to the cave. Dumbledore took me out to the cave to find Lord Voldemort's Horcruxes.
Yeah, Dylan's always been really kind of envious of Darius in a way. He definitely holds Darius as a role model. You know, yeah. Darius is like 2.5 years older than him. And I know the first time he saw Darius perform with Harry and the Potters as the Hungarian Horntails, he kind of like crossed his arms and like turned his back to him. He was just like, just enraged with jealousy. But, you know, then he went home and, you know, tried to make his own songs, you know, because he wanted to be a part of it.
Hey, baby, yeah. Do you want a close up?
I have a bookshelf over there and it's pretty much a quarter of the books I've got, you know, home. I sort of put them aside and then I graduated and I was bored out of work and I was going through stuff and I found my books again, and as soon as I opened up the first page of the first book again, I just fell into it. My grandmother was very ill when I was younger. She had strokes and she lived with us. I had a very, very special bond with her, but then when I was 7, she started breaking down. Basically, for 7 years, watched her deteriorate. When you're young and you have something going on in your house, like somebody being very ill, it's an escape. You can shut the world out that way. And that's what books are so great for, because you can just close it, go deal with your real life, come back to it when you want to. And that is why these books are the extent of popularity. I remember closing the books and going, oh, I wish this world was real. You know, you just wish you could go over to platform 9 3/4 and just keep going.
The story has become so deeply enmeshed in our culture that people want to continue and expand it in many different directions. All of those people who read it and were reshaped by it, who dreamed it, who imagined it in new ways, who fleshed it out in their stories, who sang songs about it and dressed in costumes about it, those people are as much part of the future of Harry Potter as Warner Brothers.
I have stepped away from the Daily Prophet right now because I have been diagnosed with Derkham's disease, which is a very serious condition. The disease causes the body to have a really weak immune system. And I've had to go through surgeries every other month that are very intensive.
The constant battle, even now, with chronic disease and illness, is what to do with your time. You spend so much time down, you spend so much time unable to think. They told me I was gonna die. I wanted to give up. I wanted to just lay in bed and wait for it to be done. Potter War gave me that something to do that was not only occupying my time, but it was worthwhile. I felt like I was doing something that would have an impact, and that if I was going to die, at least I would leave my mark beforehand.
A lot of 80s movies that were light sci-fi, light action or something, say like Batteries Not Included, were set in a small apartment, like a brownstone or something. All these interesting people had their little cubbies, you know, everybody had their little rooms and their specialities. It's a ragtag group of weirdos, but they come together to make a difference. They just might make it this time. There may be something badass in here. Yeah. Maybe my next favorite thing. Ah, this is one of the tops right there. She was my first crush, in fact. I loved her.
Still do.
Oh my God. This. What is that? Unidentified flying oddball. I'm buying this. Oh my God. Look at the face on that. The spaceman is a robot, a human-like robot called Hermes, and accidentally travels so fast. He's so fast, he goes in the past. They think he's a monster, and Mordred gets real mad at him. If you make a copy of this or you fuck with the copyright of this, you may have to go to prison for 5 years and or $250,000 fine for unidentified flying oddball. Like, if I wanted to, you know, even show this to my friends and then have a mic and just say, look how cool this is, this movie is the best, I could go to jail and get bow fucked and have to pay for it like I wanted it. I'll do that for as long as it takes to understand that I was so guilty. I was so guilty for talking over that movie. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. There's a policeman right there looking for Healy.
This next song's about a kid at Hogwarts who gets way too much attention for his own good.
You messed up in potions yesterday, but everyone still thinks you're really great.
For me to have seen my brother grow as a musician since we formed Draco and the Malfoys has been completely awesome. I've tried to write songs ever since I've been able to play guitar, and I could never do it. And I think it was because I could never, like, be confident enough that I actually had something to say about the world that people would care about. And then when I started writing songs from a fictional character's perspective, it just like shattered that, like, and it just came flooding out. I think that freed a lot of people up too.
It's okay, it's really great, 'cause I hate you, so does Snape.
when Draco and the Malfoys sort of really hit, I was kind of going through a rough time, and I have twins, a five-year-old twins. And I was splitting up with my wife at the time, and to have something really positive and creative to do with your time in a time in your life when really all you want to do is crawl into bed and hope it's the next day and it's going to be different was an absolute gift at the time.
I'm a fan of the movies. I own all four movies. I don't think that reading the books is stupid. I've just never gotten around to it. It sounds great. The universe is cool. The reason why it worked for me is you take this messianic prophecy. You got this kid. He shows up, man. He's going to be the biggest of all badasses. He's going to rule the school. For one, when he was a baby, the present day biggest of all badasses got fucked by him by just trying to kill him. Baby didn't even do anything, he just was like sitting there goo goo gaga, and wham, the dude dies. The mythos is already in the red in the epic scale. There's this kid who's gonna grow up, and you know what? He's having to live like a little crappy urchin under a stairwell, and he thinks he sucks. If I was a wizard and I kept hearing about this badass kid who couldn't be killed, I'd have to go see what was up. It's like the Old West, you know? It's like he's the fastest gunslinger in the world, and now he's in town, and all the gunslingers probably are just wanting to shoot him every time he goes to Chili's or something. Harry's just hanging out in a Chili's trying to eat some cheese sticks, and fucking people pulling their wands on him all the time. Harry Potter flying around with his wand, just looking for some chump ass to stick his head out. I'm so pissed that this world is like it is. No one is nice, and everybody wants money. I've got enough money to not care about money. What the fuck? Look at this pile of gold that just came out of nowhere. The turning point of the movie for me is when Harry Potter realizes that he's got money. As soon as he sees that pile of gold, he's like, I can kick back. Okay. Everything's fine. Yeah, money changes everything, even for Harry Potter.
My name is Carol Matriciana. I am a Christian film producer, director, writer, researcher. I made a film called Harry Potter Witchcraft Repackaged, Making Evil Look Innocent. It was basically to try and help people understand the dangers and the realities of witchcraft.
The question is, should parents be concerned that the alluring power behind witchcraft is being made to look innocent and is being targeted towards their children through the Harry Potter phenomenon?
It breaks my heart. It breaks my heart that it's been so polished up and cleaned up with the dangers taken away and enticing our children who are our precious property. We should be so concerned about our children, and yet we're just giving them over to the dark world of vampires, lizards, serpents, half-creatures, the dead, piercing, self-mutilation. All of this is part of occultism. To understand the power of the supernatural world is very important.
There was this girl who came to our show and she's like, I have to read Harry Potter in secret because my parents won't let me read it because they're like super conservative and like, you know, so she'd like steal her books and like read up in the attic, which is like totally cool for her, but not really, but.
The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and forces in the heavenlies and darkness in wickedness in places that we can't comprehend. And that's what we need to understand. It's a fight for our minds.
I had a reaction from my aunt who found out that Darius was in a band about Harry Potter. And she thought that it was witchcraft or something like that. She did have that initial reaction that it was sort of evil. I think she was just overly concerned because my nephew, who was 18, who was in a band, was accidentally shot in the head with a handgun. And I think she was very worried that she didn't want Darius like going down that same kind of a path. She thought maybe the music would have that influence. He was like in a punk rock type band.
You're not gonna have a kid go evil from reading Harry Potter. If they could find the proof, that's great, but we've got so much proof to the other side. Yes, the books are about witchcraft and wizardry, but much more importantly, they're about morality and bravery, and they have very, very Christian themes in them. They have self-sacrifices, fighting evil, you know, putting the fighting of evil above all things. They're so much about making sure that good triumphs.
Parents don't want to interfere. We're in a multicultural society where everybody is entitled to their own belief. There is an attraction to have power. There is an attraction to understand magic. There is a fascination. Then the kids who are reading the books are vicariously being taught the same magic that Harry is being taught, but insidiously in the comfort of their own home. So now they don't have to go out to parlors and alleys and dark alleys to learn the occult. They can tap into the internet, they can read it in books, they can sit in nice, shiny, big bookstores with coffee, people friendly, and learn about the occult in that kind of environment.
Do they even have a Bible at the library? I guess, probably, but.
There's a, theology is in the Dewey Decimal System. Yeah, it's like 500.
That supernatural thing out there is not mindful of what age, what profession, artists, creative people are usually really attracted. Mathematically sound people seem to just kind of be very happy with accounting and engineering, and they're not usually the ones that seek in that supernatural realm.
Dumbledore, we're here with you tonight.
My other band wrote a song from the perspective of a band playing in the Pope's bedchambers. You know, writing a song like, don't give up hope, you're the Pope. Like, when you're down, sometimes things get in your way, like science. But you gotta like lift up your staff even if it's heavy, and you know, put on your hat even if it's too big, and you gotta be the Pope. It was, you know, we wanted to inspire him.
Can't explain it. I'm just so happy about it. It feels nice to be able to do it myself again. It's a little bit of my normal life back. On the way home, I turned the radio up real loud and really got into it. Obeyed all the speed limits and everything. But I love it. There's a Ferrari dealership about 5 minutes from my house. And when I was 19 years old, I walked in after a bad day. When I mentioned to them that I had this idea, this crazy idea that I wanted to be a race car driver, they said, well, let's see what you can do.
And your name was?
I'm Heather. I used to be a major player in the fan culture of the Harry Potter world, but I'm moving into racing now. So I would love to be able to get involved in that. I was supposed to go to driving training last January, but got sick. Story of my life. You lose so much of your life because of diseases like this. It's not just an inconvenience. Your whole life stops. And I feel like I got a taste of being independent, working on my own. I had a regular job, and I went back to where I was as a teenager, being stuck in bed, being sick again. It felt like my life was going backwards. And that's really what ended Potter War. It's the reason that we didn't get everything we asked for, but we got as much as we needed to. I'm very proud of what I was able to do with Potter War. I'm proud that as a 16-year-old, I was able to show it doesn't matter how young you are, it doesn't matter how closed off you are. At that point, I was confined to bed. And yet, because I had the nerve to stand up and say, hey, no, this is wrong, something was done about it and something was changed.
You guys might witness a couple of sibling battles on the way down.
Don't you dare clip my arm.
These guys probably are more aggressive than a lot of other kids we know.
Yeah, that's no backfield.
I think it's the same sort of like passion that they put into learning how to do things such as, you know, write their own music or record their own music.
Darius would just make his own. Everything. I was interested in this, so I made my own whatever, bow and arrow, or yeah, he wanted to build his own violin and be like a woodworker.
Darius, punch me!
We're just gonna switch these guys. Guys, not cool at all.
One time I made a movie. It was called The Weather Kids. It was about, I'm a tornado and a hurricane kid. Holden's lightning.
Electric.
Lightning, you mean, Holden. And Oliver,
no,
Oliver
was electric. Thunderstorm.
No, but he was actually rain, remember? Oh yeah, he was rain. Precipitation.
Hey, what's going on here, Holden?
It's not going on.
You have the mark. You can light.
Hear that from my wand again. The meteorologist is so bad. He wants to destroy weather. Oh, finally. Good. Oh.
Go back thousands of years of human history. People gathered around the campfire to retell the stories of great cultural heroes, to tell them in ways that were personally meaningful, that were meaningful to their families, to their clans, to their tribes. Stories were added to and rounded out and fleshed out by this process of oral storytelling that opened up new possibilities for the imagination, new possibilities for meaning.
I really hate these Goonies. They are so bad.
Oh no, here's another one.
That's how it has always been, I think. People get excited about some work, some art that's been done, that's out there, that they love or hate even, you know. They just get, it gets them excited or stirred up and they want to do something themselves. Whenever I was younger and first teaching myself how to draw, all I did was copy. So I'd just find an interesting panel in a comic book and I would just try to exactly imitate the person's line.
I've always been interested in comic books and single panel type comics and comics that'll be in the newspapers. And I started drawing something called Crease Comics, which is what I called it. It's just a single panel type of cartoon.
I'm still getting used to this thing right here. I like to be able to be somewhere and not be reached, but that's all over. That's terribly over now.
Through a friend of a friend who maybe passed my number on to somebody who was trying to make some money making a ringtone for cell phones that had an image that went with it or something, or maybe like a video that we could sell. I hated that idea and never wanted to do anything like that, and I never considered myself an animator, but I thought, well, if I could make a little money, I'll see what I can do. So I made this cartoon with some dudes singing a song about George Washington.
Washington, Washington, 6'20", fucking killing for fun. He's coming, he's coming, he's coming. Sue me if I go too fast, but the sons of his opponents wish that he was their dad.
Got a wig for his wig. Got
got a brain for his heart.
He'll kick you apart. He'll kick you apart. Ooh.
A week or two afterwards, I had it done and sent it to him. And he was like, oh man, that's not that good. He didn't like it. And he wanted me to maybe do something that was more commercial with it. Mention like Snoop Dogg and Jessica Simpson instead of George Washington.
He'll save children, but not the British children. He'll save children, but not the British children. He'll save children, but not the British children.
He had a pocket full of horses, fucked the shit out of bears.
It's like my life is so dictated by media, just being an audience member, just so much entertainment and like everything that, everything I have to do or say is so much half-acidly a response to what I've watched and seen. Before you know it, that's just how I describe things, by like, oh man, stop being so Willow on that, or you know. you know, I mean, just earlier, we were talking like in Transformer talk, you know? Hold on a second, I need to take this. Hello, pharmacy.
I did a couple of infomercial type things. They were movies to show would-be pharmacists.
Yeah, hi, sweetheart.
I played a pharmacist that was doing all the wrong things, like talking on the phone to a friend of mine about getting tickets for docking.
I'm sorry, it's Aerosmith, you know, it's...
Right.
I mean, I never met somebody, you know, Joe Perry is so freaking amazing.
There's another one where I'm a handicapped student, like in a wheelchair.
Hey, Ellen.
I'd given up on trying to do acting. I'd given up on anything having to do with movies or entertainment in this way. I was thinking more of maybe drawing comics again.
And then Silver Deluxe came and visited me and said, hey, we want you to make more cartoons. Thanks. My job now is making animations for this website. It's a branch of TBS, who owns Cartoon Network and Adult Swim. And when they approached me, they were like, we like Grease Comics and have you just make more stuff like that. It is funny that my life now, my job, my opportunities that I have, where I'm going, is a direct result of people liking Wizard People. My favorite moment in Wizard People is when Harry gets so pissed off in the child sorting ceremony. It's become apparent that people are talking about him and people know the story about him, and he's already totally over the fame aspect and it's getting on his nerves. I think a lot of us have been there where you're all of a sudden, everybody's looking at you and expecting something out of you and stuff. And then a lot of time, go back to that moment now, kind of making a lot of cartoons and you know, a fair amount of people are fans and email me and have questions and not just requests, but demands. And I, a lot of the time, feel like that exact inner dialogue of Harry Potter sitting on that stool. I think back to Wizard People all the time. I probably will never be able to make something that I like so much. Isn't that funny?
Daniel Radcliffe stars in a very controversial stage play that is starring in London. I saw these huge posters, I mean, oh, 50, 60 foot high, outside the theatre where he stars in Equus, which is a young stable boy involved in erotic sex with horses.
I would love to know how many girls are going there just to see Harry Potter naked. And it's unfortunate, because now it's a whole other aspect to Harry Potter that is so funny, because Warner Brothers has been fighting that kind of angle to their franchise for so long, fighting slash fiction writers, fighting all of that. We don't want any of that nudity or pornography associated with our franchise. And here their star is going off and being nude in a play.
I'm not sure whether Daniel fully understands the implications of what he's done. And of course, that's up to him. Did he understand the implications of what he began when he was a little lovable witch?
if they're going to hold the fans to such a high level of behavior, they should be sending themselves and Daniel Radcliffe a cease and desist letter. Because, hey, I mean, it's all about being fair and keeping things even.
They want to make money. I'm sure Warner Brothers is going to take Daniel Radcliffe. I mean, I don't know. How do I know? Let me look into my crystal ball. Hang on a moment.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, I'm so tired. It was in 2005 when I first had the idea about, this is an amazing time for fans. There's never going to be a time about this again. Somebody needs to write this all down. That concept going to reality took a long time. And I would come home from work, make sure Leaky was okay, and work until 2-3 o'clock in the morning on the proposal and make sure I got like 6 hours of sleep and then like start it over. Finally, I finished it. We had to do some revisions. I finished it in mid-November, and it went out, and Simon & Schuster picked it up and gave me a healthy advance, and it's going to be published in 2008. I think the biggest thing I keep going back to is that it's been a huge lesson in following your passion, because I thought Harry Potter would be fun. I started playing with it, and because I did that, now I have a nonfiction book that's expected to do well, that will be a major stage for my first novel that is my real career. Somewhere in the middle of this, Harry Potter became my real career. You know, forever, this will be the story of, you know, in literary form, the story of the Harry Potter fandom, and I sit and I think about this awesome time in history, and that I've been charged with capturing it for people so that they can remember, so that they could take it home and show their kids, this is what your mother lived through with Harry Potter.
Are you guys ready to get some reading done tonight? Are you ready to kill Voldemort by reading? Lost Sirius Black, but we're not turning back. We will fight till we have won, and Voldemort is gone, and I'm gonna do whatever it takes. I don't care about whatever fate that prophecy says. No, I'm not afraid. No, I'm not afraid. 'Cause there's one thing that I've got, one thing that you've got inside you too, one thing that we've got, and the one thing we've got is enough to save us all. The weapon we have is love. The weapon we have is love. The weapon we have is love.
Good.
The weapon we have is love. The weapon we have is love. The weapon we have is love.
All eyes are heavy. The day has been a storm of excitements, and the children, after laying out their uniforms and shoes, are quickly starring in each other's dreams. It is a beautiful pale blue night. We see Harry stroking his bird, lost in thought, bathed in the cold water of moonlight. Who am I now, he thinks, as he winks at the night, and it seems to whisper back to him, you are everything. They are a ragtag group of champions, this bunch. His teammates and he swim through the air, testing out the space of the enormous field of play. He is so ravenous, he can hardly keep from flying over and chomping the fingers off his opponents in a gesture of what's to come. The crowd is destroying its throats, calling Harry's name. Harry feels right with himself. He's down there, a new god who has found a calling. He holds up that snitch and bellows, I am a beautiful animal. I am a destroyer of worlds. I am Harry fucking Potter. And dear readers, at last the world was quiet.